The ideas expressed in the following presentations are those of the speakers and do not necessarily reflect the views of ACI or its committees. ACI web sessions are recorded at ACI conventions or other concrete industry events and will be made available for viewing free of charge for 1 week. Thereafter, they will be archived on the ACI website or added to ACI's online CEU program, depending on their content. You can earn continuing education credits through ACI's online CEU program. Visit www.concrete.org to register. ACI conventions provide an opportunity for networking and for keeping up to date with the latest in concrete technology and practices.
The next presentation we have is with Linda Lamb, and again I'm going to ask her to explain a little bit about her company Transsolar and her roles there, rather than me brutalizing an introduction.
Thank you. Hi everyone, my name is Linda and I work for Transsolar Climate Engineering. I'm a project engineer there, and I do primarily thermal simulations and validation of concepts that we develop relating to passive design, and maybe also semi-passive design as well. Actually, before I was at Transsolar, I worked at Flack & Kurtz over in San Francisco for about 2 years, and I worked there primarily with eQuest, kind of doing a lot of thermal energy, whole building energy simulation, a lot of lead models, and that kind of a thing. And once I've gotten to Transsolar, I've started to shift my focus more towards passively designed buildings. Today I'm going to talk a little bit about thermal mass simulation accuracy and the design considerations associated with it. Hopefully there might be a little bit of overlap with the talks that have happened already today, but please bear with me as I try to tell you my story. So even before the concept of building physics, humans have been able to figure out for themselves how they can protect themselves from the elements and what makes them comfortable. And I believe that these castle walls, these thick castle walls, are a perfect example of this kind of intuitive discovery. Because even though it's very possible that these castle walls were built for the purposes of structural integrity and protection from other feudal warlords, I think that eventually people realized that in these kinds of spaces that they've created, they felt comfortable. It was warmer in the winter and cooler in the summer. So to rehash, these are the concepts, right? In the wintertime, you've got solar radiation coming into your space, either through openings or conducting through your walls, and being absorbed by all the surfaces before being released in the evening when it gets colder outside. And in the summer, a very similar phenomenon occurs, except that in the during the nighttime of the summer, you want to employ strategies such as night ventilation to cool this heat off, to recharge your massive surfaces, to prepare them for the heat that will come the next day. And now, taking a closer look at the interactions of the thermodynamic processes occurring in a space, you can see that you've got surfaces radiating towards your occupants and with each other, and you might have some airflow coming through, whether it's through the window or through a diffuser, and you've got solar radiation coming through. And amidst all of this, all of these heat flows, you've got your occupants. And I feel that a lot of the time the occupant gets lost. And the reasons for all of these systems that we design, it's to make the occupant comfortable. And if the occupant isn't comfortable at the end of the day, regardless of how much energy you saved, you've kind of failed, right? So the question is how we can incorporate and capture all of these processes together. And already our speakers today have mentioned a lot of software that's available to model these kinds of thermal interactions. But I'm going to focus on two specific pieces of software, primarily the heat balance model that is used in Transit 17, which is what we use at Transsolar, and the method that gets used in other simulation engines, particularly DO2. And then I'm going to go into a short discussion about thermal comfort evaluation and how operative temperature relates to that, and how exactly which one of these methods can actually help you design for thermal comfort more accurately. And then just mention a couple of factors that would help you maximize your thermal mass design, incorporating thermal mass design in your building. And then just wrap up with a couple of examples of thermal mass applications used in conjunction with active slab, night cooling, and the solar chimney. So just a quick review of the basics, right? You've got energy, which is essentially exergy plus entropy. Exergy is the actual useful work that's performed when you're trying to get your system to get to come into equilibrium. And the entropy is the kind of wasted energy, so to speak. And when it comes to passive concepts, it's all about using these low exergy sources. And essentially what that means is that the lower the difference in temperature between your cooling source and your goal room temperature, the more efficiently your system will come into equilibrium. So for example, groundwater cooling. Using groundwater cooling in your radiant slab, since groundwater is generally at a very constant mild temperature throughout the year, it's closer to your goal temperature in your space than, say, really cold chilled water at, you know, 55, 52 degrees Fahrenheit. And again, you're, of course, you've got your three forms of heat transfer: conduction, convection, and radiation. And just the point that I wanted to make with this particular slide was that heat is per unit of time. And so understanding this, you should keep in your mind that what the energy flow that is occurring at one time step affects the energy that is exerted at the next time step. So here we come to the first method. And this, I guess, the name is a little deceiving here that I've used for the transfer function method, since all the software today actually uses transfer functions. But what I want to point out is the relationship that is shown by these equations here. So first, if you take a look at this diagram to the left, it's a summary of all of the radiative and convective heat flows onto the inner and outer surfaces of a wall. And to the right of it is the equations of the heat fluxes that result from these convective and radiative flows. And you'll notice that the first two terms of each of these equations is based on the temperature of the inner and outer surfaces, whereas the third term of these equations is actually the heat fluxes that occurred at the previous time step. So in essence, incorporating this this thermal history, so to speak. Okay, and so in order to kind of delve into these equations a little bit further, if you take this example of a wall, the material properties are actually integrated into these heat transfer function equations. So the coefficients A, B, C, and D are solved for, and these are what are called the response factors. And essentially, your real wall is condensed into this black box model so that it gets reduced to being described by the heat fluxes and the temperatures through the inner and outer surfaces. And so when you've got these equations that define this wall, the simulation program solves iteratively based on the number of time steps that you tell it to. And that's the variable k. And generally speaking, the higher the k, the more iterations. And so a higher k is required for heavier walls, and a lower k is generally used for lightweight walls. So this is actually an equation that I extracted from the DOE 2.1 Engineer's Manual. It's a little old, but I wasn't able to find a more recent version of the equation. But I mean, just a big red circle right there. There's no history that I can understand from this equation. And the first two terms are very similar to the other equations that I just showed you that were derived by Mitalas and Arsenault. But the T inside that's referred to there, the T surface inside, is actually set to just the T air of the space, so the air temperature of the space. So there's no difference in this particular equation between the air temperature and the surface temperature, and that's just not true in real life. Right, so why bother, right? Because if you do use transis, which incorporates this thermal history factor, you end up having a lot more iterations in order to solve your system of equations. But the reasons why you would actually want to choose a method like that is because then you would be able to know the surface temperature. And knowing the surface temperature is very important when it comes to controls. Not only is surface temperature used to control things like radiant system, but it also would come into play when you're trying to provide condensation prevention. Now, the other reason is, I guess, a little more commonly known, and that is that thermally massive systems allow you to shift your peak and reduce your loads, consequently. And in order to talk about that, I've proposed two different boundaries here. And the first boundary on your left is cut off right where your supply and water return are located. Whereas in the second one on the right, the cutoff of the boundary is where the heat flows into this panel. So taking this kind of typical office space, for example, and assuming that supply air and return air provide the same amount of cooling in both situations. When you compare these two boundaries, that's how you see the thermal lag that actually occurs. And that's shown here in this graph of power here along the left-hand side is in watts per meter squared, and along the bottom is just the time of the day. And I've just shown here for a typical day in, I want to say, sometime in June. And so if you take a look at this, the sharper blue line here, the taller one, this represents the left-hand side situation where your system boundary is drawn where the supply and water temperatures are. And the way to read this line is that In the morning, your space is kind of heating up and it's getting warm inside. And at some point, your system controls are set up to flip the switch on the mass flow of your radiant system. And that's what this is. So since the water is the coldest, this means that your delta T is the highest. And so this is when your system is working the hardest. And then as the water runs throughout the day, it kind of loses its capacity and drops off until the end of the day or so. Now, so that was just the system boundary. Then if you wanted to look at the zone boundary, you would have to look at this this light green line here. Sorry for the other lines, but and the way to read this green line is that at nighttime you don't have any heat gains in the space, and so there's no heat flux into the panels. And then gradually, as the day begins and people start coming in, the lights start turning on, computers start turning on, the flux into the panel increases, and it actually peaks at about 4 p.m. instead of noon. So this difference between the peaks at noon and at 4 p.m. Is essentially illustrates this thermal lag effect. And technically, you could actually size your system based on this power curve instead of this dark blue one, because this is actually the instantaneous demand from your space. And so if you're able to size to a more realistic number, you end up not having to put as much money in as a first cost, that's one, and two, you would reduce your system size, so you would have smaller chillers or smaller equipment in general. And this is, I think it was mentioned a little bit earlier, the best test, the standard 140, in which you can compare the various building simulation software. And I just want to point out here a comparison of Transys, which is in this blue, this dark blue color, compared to the red bar, which is Trace 700 version 6.2. And actually, I'm sorry, this should say peak cooling for a high mass building. You can see that Trace grossly overpredicts the peak cooling that's required for a high mass building. And you know, this could be the difference of, you know, 100 tons or something. So that could really affect your first cost and system size. And then finally, going back to this importance of the surface temperature, it's the surface temperature is not only important in terms of controls, but it also affects your operative temperature. And your operative temperature basically defines what your comfort, your thermal comfort is in the space. And so your operative temperature is a combination of the temperatures of all of your various surfaces that you're exposed to, such as, you know, the ceiling, any panels that might be hanging, the wall temperatures, the floor temperatures, the glass temperatures, and, you know, additionally, any airspeed that gets felt on your skin, whether it's draft or from the windows. And the operative temperature essentially captures all of that. Air temperature is just one component of this. And to emphasize this even more, the ASHRAE 55, which is the thermal comfort standard, is actually based on the operative temperature. So I guess this is a psychrometric chart where you have operative temperature along the bottom and humidity along the y-axis. And these boxes delineate the regions in which you would be comfortable in the winter and the summer seasons. And just another snapshot from ASHRAE 55. The radiant temperature asymmetry graph, this basically tells you the number of the percent of people who would be dissatisfied if you had a difference in temperature between, for example, a warm ceiling, you would have 6% of your people would be dissatisfied if your Fahrenheit, if your the difference between your ceiling and your operative temperature is 9 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's how to read this graph. And if you had a cool ceiling, then you would read this line. But again, it's the emphasis on being able to know what surface temperatures are, and then as a result, knowing what your operative temperatures are. So once you know these, once you have been able to accurately simulate these thermally massive spaces, how can you maximize its potential? And one of the ways is that you're able to more accurately predict the effect of things like external shading, which often gets downgraded because they're just not accurately modeled. And on top of that, you're able to do creative things like expand your basis of design. And by that, I mean being able to define separate boundary conditions, like typical conditions, so that for 90% of the year, your operative temperature in your office spaces will be 60 degrees Fahrenheit. And then for 76 degrees in the summertime, whereas the actual extreme permissible conditions, which might occur maybe only 5% of the time out of the year, you'll design to 86 degrees Fahrenheit. And by doing things like that, being able to talk to your design team and working out whether or not these kinds of adjustments are possible, you could significantly reduce your system size and be able to work around the standard way of doing things, the conventional way of doing things. And then finally, you can use thermal mass in combination with semi-passive and active systems. These are a few snapshots of earth ducts. And earth ducts, I don't know if you guys have any experience with them. Maybe I see a few smirks, they're essentially long concrete tunnels that help you pre-condition your air before it's supplied into the space. And they're very popular in Europe. And I think maybe the smirks are coming from condensation questions and mold issues and concerns relating to that. But if it's designed correctly, there generally shouldn't be any issues with this. And it actually, if you have the space for it, and if it works with your construction logistics, it provides a lot of pre-cooling and preheating, since it takes directly from the ground temperature. And then in terms of water, you know, instead of using air, you can also use geothermal, as our prior speakers have mentioned. And I guess I'll kind of skip through that, some pictures. And so for active slabs, I guess that's more of an active system, but they were they failed during the 1930s, mostly because buildings back then had really poor envelopes. And also on top of that, the open loop steel piping systems were exposed, had a lot of exposure to oxygen. And so a lot of the steel pipes started to corrode. But they're actually quite popular in Europe, and they're very successful, as you know, the thermal mass stabilizes the room temperature, and it's noiseless, draft-free, and inexpensive there. And since you have milder supply temperatures, your heat pumps and your chillers actually operate more efficiently, milder water supply temperatures. And on top of that, you were able to also implement things like groundwater wells and wet cooling towers. And unpopular in the US, I think that until recently, there's been kind of an indifference towards occupant comfort, and radiant slab systems are really geared towards the occupant. And obviously, another reason is that energy costs are much, much lower here, and so electricity is cheap. So there's no reason why we should try and go for these other lower energy systems. And I guess I want to skip over this, but I'm just getting to, I guess, the final part of my presentation here, in which I just wanted to show you a couple of examples of built or in-progress buildings that utilize active slab. And the one that I kind of glazed over quickly here, this is a school in Damascus, and this is completely naturally ventilated, with the exception that it uses this kind of mini earth duct here to precondition the air before it gets supplied into the space. It's assisted by a stack ventilation through a solar chimney, as well as utilizing prevailing wind. So it's oriented in such a way as to have the prevailing wind assist with drawing air through. And it's built, and it's working, and the students are really happy. And so this other project that I was personally involved with, and it's currently being built, is the Baltimore Law School. And this, the Baltimore Law School has got a couple of modes, but in general, it's got active slab cooling, and it's integrated into the slab, so that air that gets supplied into this space then goes into the gets transferred into the atrium, and then exhausted out at the top. And the same in the winter time. And there's a natural ventilation mode. And so that's the rendering, and that's it being built. A picture of the active slab before the concrete is poured. And this is the current progress, actually, just now. Yeah, and then I guess the last project that I wanted to take a quick look at the stats on is the Manitoba Hydro Building. And this is kind of our poster child project because it was designed for a climate that ranges between 31 degrees Fahrenheit and 95. So that's really cold to really hot. And it's a tall building, and you know, it provides ventilation and conditioning for 2,000 employees, and it's got 100% fresh air year-round, and that's primarily due to the high-performance envelope and the radiant ceiling slab that is utilized in the space, among other things like the solar chimney. And so, again, this building is built, and we're actually we've been collecting energy data on it since 2010, and we're hoping that it matches up with our transits model. But I don't have that information right now.